kind of observing how your dementia is going. You know,
giving care to Alzheimer's patients. Next, on Black Nouveau. Hi, I'm Milton Dyer.
And I'm Faith Collis. Welcome to Black Nouveau. This week, our series on Alzheimer's disease concludes as we meet Pearl Cannon, a Milwaukeean who has been a caregiver to two relatives with Alzheimer's.
We'll profile jazz artist Regina Carter, and we'll preview the third annual Fresh Coast Classic.
But first, the art of Xenobia Bailey. She has a reputation for making bold, beautiful, and stunning art, and some of it is to wear. Bobby Drake has more.
In the American story, artists from far and wide fuse personal identity with cultural heritage. Xenobia Bailey dives into the African-American aesthetic of crochet.
Now, with the aesthetic that you learned in school and what you had grown up with, is this a combination of those works, or is this your idea of the African-American aesthetic?
My instructors told me there was no such thing as an African-American aesthetic, and I told them there was, because that's how I was in art school, because I was that's the aesthetic that I was raised on, because I deal with the aesthetic of funk. It's really based on an emotional rhythm, pattern kind of development, and the color combinations. There's no set technique to do it, except for the stitching. But as far as the surface design, you know when it works and you know when it doesn't work.
When did you start displaying your works, or this collection?
Well, this collection started at the turn of the century. Started doing a residency. I was in the Studio Museum of Harlem. Nothing was done as far as that residency was concerned. And I titled that Paradise Under Reconstruction in the Aesthetic of Funk. That was the first stage. From there, I was just working for 7 years. It was a 7-year project. I was just working on different components, kind of trying to build the whole concept together. I started with the hats. The hats, I used myself as the muse.
Right.
And I started designing hats that I could wear to the different functions and different things that I go to develop that lifestyle. Hats take about 2 weeks to do. The other pieces are the mandalas. They're points of concentration for meditation. These are based off of a lot of inspirational and spiritual artifacts from different cultures, and combining the aesthetic of funk to it.
Does each one of these pieces, like some of these are just, they look so extremely vast and time consuming. How long does it normally take you to do a piece?
What I do with each piece is I just do individual circles. Mm-hmm. And I just do like a bunch of different circles, different sizes, and then I'll just all of a sudden stop and take the largest piece and put it on the wall. And then I'll take another piece and I'll start composing the different pieces. And then after I see that it's where I want it to be, then I start putting the blanket stitch to stitch them all together. But it's a phase of a lot of crocheting, and the largest pieces take about a month to do, maybe a couple of weeks to a month to do. Mm-hmm. And the smaller pieces, I don't even know, because I'm just, you know, I never really time them or
right.
anything. But the tent took about 6 months to do. This tent here took about six months to do.
And you put the garments for each one of these?
Yeah, I made the garments. Yeah. I made everything for them. The faces are made out of terracotta clay. I made a mold for them. And then I painted it over with acrylic paint. Mm-hmm. And then I made their dresses.
In addition to her artwork, Xenobia has also developed a workshop.
Black. It's in my head right now. Goodness.
What is the workshop itself about?
The workshop itself is about creativity and community development. And that's what this is. This is a community. And this is a community that's like gypsies on the road, you know. And like what we're doing, we set up camp here. Mm-hmm. And we have the workshops in the artery. And from that workshops, we're trying to stimulate, inspire creativity within the communities wherever we go. And really, it's something that everybody can do right now. Because like In every household, somebody knows how to crochet. Somebody knows how to knit. Somebody knows how to sew, you know. Okay. So it's just being inspired to do it, you know. But all this, nothing is new. None of it is new. It's all about the needle, the imagination, and just taking the time to do it. With a heap of yarn and imagination, and your imagination takes you to, you know,
new
wherever
heights.
You want to go, you know, it's like your magic carpet ride.
One of Milwaukee's newest traditions will take place again this year over Thanksgiving weekend, the third annual Fresh Coast Classic. Here to discuss the unique mix of basketball and college information are Victor Barnett, founder and director of the Running Rebels Community Organization, and Harold Scott, chairman of the Fresh Coast Classic Board. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you, Milton.
We have a great deal to talk about in a short amount of time. Tell us about the event this year.
Well, this year, it's a unique event in that we're moving to a new venue. We're going to be at Pottawatomie's brand new Exposition and Convention Center. This is a first for us, and we will be their inaugural sporting event. So we're looking forward to that. In the same location, very nearby, we're going to conduct our third annual college fair. And each year the college fair has grown to the point where we're at 38 different folks being representatives of various colleges and institutions. So,
why the change?
Why the change? Well, there's a couple reasons for the change. Number one, we started out in the Midwest Center, which is not, it's a wonderful place, but it's not a place where you would normally expect to see basketball.
Okay.
But that got us started. Last year we were at the U.S. Cellular Arena, another outstanding place, a large place. And in all honesty, you gotta crawl before you walk.
Definitely.
And if you think about that, its size and so forth, and where we are in our history, okay. We thought it was a little bit early. Okay. So we decided that this would be a nice place to go this year.
Harold, who do you want to participate? Who do you want to participate?
Well, the community. Definitely we feel good about the support from the sponsors, very pleased with the support, and we're hoping that we can get the community behind it. Been working in the community 29 years now and really excited about getting the community to come together and work with the corporate together to make a very successful event this year.
Who are for your sponsors?
Beg your pardon?
Who are for your sponsors?
May I answer that?
Definitely.
Yes. Let me make sure. The issue for us is that we get the sponsorship. We got Harley-Davidson this year. We got Pottawatomie this year. Manpower's there. This will be their third year being with us. This will be the third year that We Energies has been with us. And M&I is with us again for the third year. We've got the Mandel Group, where Barry Mandel is a big proponent of college education, particularly for inner city kids. And he actually sponsors the college fair. We've got Johnson Control. They're certainly another big sponsor. And Evinrude. Is also another major sponsor for us. So that's our list of major sponsors. We have a number of other sponsors that perhaps aren't at that level. But every year we seem to be able to attract the corporate community to support and participate with us in this great idea. We really need to see the community step up.
Okay.
Every year we get community support, but not nearly like we get it from corporate America.
So you have a tremendous amount of corporate support.
Right.
But you need additional community support. How are you going about doing that, though?
Well, the way we approach it is we're taking a much more grassroots level, okay? We're out in the community. We're at a number of locales with after parties and so forth. We're moving from what we would call local yokels, if you will,
okay. Which
is much better than giving books and banks of tickets to large corporations who may or may not help you fill the stadium. And that's what we need. We need people to come and see NCAA-sanctioned basketball at its best. And if you come, that's the attraction.
Okay.
But really, bring your sons, your daughters, your cousins, your nieces, your nephews to come to this college fair.
Quickly, who are the teams playing this year?
This year we've got Elizabeth City. Elizabeth City last year was the champion, so we expect them to come back and defend it.
Okay.
We've got Clafton University coming to see us. Clark Atlanta's coming to play this year. We look forward for them to give us a good game.
Okay.
And Lincoln out of Missouri is coming.
Tell us about the college fair.
The college fair, it's actually a little bit more than just a college fair. And it has representatives from a variety of schools, some local schools, but mostly historically black colleges, okay? And it's not just the colleges themselves. There's counselors there that talk about college life. There's counselors there that talk about finance to get into college. So it's more, what we want young people to see is a little bit more than just the location and what the school offers, but a little bit of a sense of what goes on at college and what to expect when they arrive. As part of our show with the basketball, we're expecting to have some step shows. Again, something that gives people a sense of what it's like to go to college, what's expected of them, and also anything that's going to help them succeed.
So stressing what college life is like,
right.
But most importantly, learning a lot of information about colleges.
About college, yes.
How do people get more information?
I would suggest that they go on our website, www.freshcoastclassic.org, and everything you need to know is right there.
Gentlemen, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
Carter is considered one of the best jazz violinists in the genre. Liddy Collins lets you hear why.
Violinist Regina Carter hails from the Midwest, Detroit, Michigan. She's labeled a jazz violinist, though her training was in European classical music. She plays in a lot of genres. She's played with numerous artists from jazz greats such as Ray Brown, Kenny Barron, to R&B greats Aretha Franklin, Mary J. Blige, and Lauryn Hill. She's played with numerous orchestras, including the Milwaukee Symphony Orchestra. Mother, a teacher, and grandmother, a 1915 graduate of Morris Brown College, thought music an important part of life. So at the early age of 2, she started playing piano and Suzuki at 4. From there, she fell in love with a violin. Music was her life in grade school and high school. She attended Case Technical High School in Detroit. She said it was pretty intense, and by the time she got to college, she could test out of some of her first year classes. In college, she double majored in classical and African American music.
What was it like for an African American female in the arts? Growing up in your teenage years, then leaving Detroit, going to this other world, what was it like?
It was interesting to leave Detroit at the time that I did, because when I grew up, Detroit was a very ethnically mixed city. And so I was exposed to so many different cultures and their arts without having to ever leave the city. When I left the city and went to college, I went to school at New England Conservatory in Boston. That was the biggest shock of my life. There was no campus. There were only two buildings, the dormitory and the music building across the street, smack dab in the city. So you're just in the city. And I wasn't mature enough, I think, to handle just being thrust into a new city and a new way of living just overnight. And Boston has its racial issues, and they're out in the open for you. And so I had many experiences that I'd never had before. My roommate, a pianist, Rachel Z, and I, we were roommates the first year, and we would go to Berkeley sometimes and hang out at the jam session. So we were coming home very late at night, just the two of us. And one night, we didn't know it, unbeknownst to us, someone had followed us home, and our dorm mother called us the next morning and said, some gentleman followed you home and said that you all were prostitutes and that you tried to rob him of his money, and it was just, we didn't even see anyone. Or I remember someone, a group of guys going by in a car and calling her an in-lover. And she yelled something back. She was from a small town. I said, you never say anything back. You just keep going and try and hurry and get home. And they got out of the car and chased us. Luckily, coming from a city, my father always taught me, meet people in your neighborhood. So I knew that, you know, I ran into a store and they helped us. They called the police and the guys didn't. They came into the store and saw that these people were going to help us and left us alone. So it was an intense change, and I was experiencing some things that I wasn't used to. I didn't want to become used to. So after 2 years, I went back to Detroit. I went to school. I finished at Oakland University in Rochester, Michigan. And for me, that was much better.
In 2001, Regina Carter traveled to Genoa, Italy, and made history by becoming the first jazz musician and first African-American to play the most famous violin in classical music, the legendary El Canone Guarneri de Gesù violin, owned by classical virtuoso and composer Paganini.
And it's a violin that was made by Guarneri, who was a contemporary of Stradivarius, and they both are in Cremona in Italy. And Paganini was this great violinist who was said to have made a pact with the devil because he would break all the strings on his violin, it was said, except for one string, and play a whole piece on this one string. And so for me, I laugh at it because it was marketing. It was great marketing back then even. But he lost his violin in a gambling debt, so the story goes, and Guarneri loaned him this violin. And the violin is very special because it's bigger than most full-size violins, but it has a very dark sound. It sounds almost more like a viola than a violin, and it projects so much that it's not something you need a microphone with. So when people hear it live next to another really great violin, you really hear the difference in this. And it's a 250-year-old violin. It's priceless. It's in a museum in Genoa. The community owns it. And usually European classical musicians or violinists who win a Paganini competition each year, they're allowed to play this violin.
Playing this violin came with much protest from the people of Genoa, saying Regina Carter was disrespecting the Guarneri violin by playing jazz, which they felt a lesser music. Carter changed their minds with her performance and returned in 2002 to become the first jazz musician to record an album with the Guarneri violin.
And that's when I recorded Paganini After a Dream.
Regardless of what violin Regina Carter performs on, her talent comes through.
Thank you very much.
Last week, we introduced you to Justine McCord, a woman in the beginning stages of Alzheimer's, a progressive and fatal brain disease that is the seventh leading cause of death in the United States. This week, we're going to look at the impact the disease has on families and caregivers. Pearl Cannon is no newcomer to providing care to a loved one with Alzheimer's. In 1999, her mother was diagnosed with a disease. Pearl cared for her until her death in 2004.
That was kind of frightening because I knew not too much about it. I'd heard about Alzheimer's, but she was diagnosed with dementia, stage 2. And at this point, the healthcare provider, which is her doctor, advised me that he strongly advised that she not live alone at this point.
Pearl says going through the experience with her mother prepared her for her husband's Alzheimer's diagnosis.
My memory is not as good as it used to be. First, on top of that, my body's breaking down physically. I know it's in the mind, but that's just one part of the sickness. restless in my body. I'm 78 years old.
You know, you look fantastic.
But, you know, I just feel I can't do it. I'm not able to do things I used to do.
When was the first time you noticed that you were having Alzheimer's symptoms? Did you notice, or Pearl, did you notice first?
He noticed. He noticed about 10 or 15 years ago. He was a leader, an elder at our church, and he said he wasn't remembering and recalling like he should, to the point of being frustrated, like he thought he might forget something, you know, if he was up, you know, presenting to the congregation. So he said he was going to retire, and he did.
He had Alzheimer's at the same time that you all were caring for your mother who had Alzheimer's.
He had undiagnosed.
Okay.
He hadn't been diagnosed. He wasn't diagnosed till 08.
Okay. So from 99 to 08, Mr. Cannon had symptoms.
He had symptoms.
Okay. And there was no diagnosis until 08. So what kind of, he wasn't getting any medical care?
No medical care. He got great recall, but as he say, he can't remember 10 minutes from now what mm-hmm. he did 10 minutes ago. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, mm-hmm. that's the short term. Mm-hmm. But he tells stories all the time, giving me the downline of the family.
Okay. So I'm always one in the family on both sides, you know.
Oh, okay. So you know all the history.
Oh, yeah.
And at every funeral, he says, if you want to know something, ask me. Mm-hmm.
In November 2008, the Alzheimer's Association recognized Pearl as Caregiver of the Year for completing the Association's Facilitators Program for support groups.
I just appreciate the encouragement and love that has been shown to me. And last night when I sat among the board of directors and different ones telling their stories, I didn't feel so alone.
She is now a facilitator at her church and provides support to other caregivers.
And joining me is Dr. Dimitri Mills, Multicultural Outreach Coordinator for the Alzheimer's Association. Welcome back, Dr. Mills.
Thank you.
What are the warning signs that a parent or relative may be, that they may display, that we should notice as it relates to Alzheimer's?
Warning signs can vary. One typical warning sign is when a loved one who has been interested in doing certain activities are no longer interested in doing those things. People that are inappropriately dressing, putting on piles and piles of clothes in the summertime and no clothes in the wintertime. When bills pile up and things are, they're not eating properly. Those are typical warning signs.
What should we do when we see those signs?
We really should have that individual evaluated. And the reason I say that is because if we can eliminate other things that can contribute to the same symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, then that's better off. That makes our quality of life better off. If it comes down to a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, what we can do then is to increase the quality of life for a longer period of time through medications and other treatments.
What should a family member be aware of when they're supporting a relative with Alzheimer's?
Depending on the stage, one of the because Alzheimer's disease is a disease that destroys brain cells. And depending on the stage, we have to understand that that's not the person that we knew before, and not to take any behaviors or forgetfulness as being personal.
You talked about stages. You mentioned stages. Can you elaborate on that a bit? Is it three phases, five phases? What would those stages look like?
Typically, many practitioners want to go through seven stages. I personally like three. The reason for that is that they overlap, the symptoms overlap in each stage. And so I look at early stage, middle stage, and late stage.
Are there any specific signs that go along with each of those stages that may be more advanced than the last or the
previous? Well, the progression of the memory loss and the cognitive abilities increase through each of the phases that people go through. The last stage is really the critical one where they don't recognize anyone, they can't do any of their daily activities by themselves.
I can imagine that being a caregiver has to be an extremely exhausting duty and responsibility. What's available for caregivers?
There are many things that are available. Support groups is one way. Respite care is another. And there's just the more information that you get about the disease, the better you are able to cope with that with the loved one.
And you mentioned support groups. Can people get involved with those at the Alzheimer's Association?
Yes, we have a listing of support groups that we have started and trained facilitators on. For the African American community, we have a first ever in Milwaukee African American community support group at Brentwood Church.
Do they get training to maybe provide support for other caregivers after they've had this experience?
They can come through the Alzheimer's Association and become a facilitator. We train facilitators for support groups.
And how long have you been doing the outreach to the African American community about Alzheimer's and about caregiving support?
The Alzheimer's Association has always done outreach to the African American community. However, that was spread out, and now we are concentrating. We have myself that primarily deals with the African American community in education and information and referral.
And how can families find out more about caregiving support and about Alzheimer's?
They can call the Alzheimer's Association during regular business hours, 414-479-8800. And we have a 24/7 helpline at 1-800-272-3900. Call anytime.
Dr. Mills, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome.
And that wraps up this edition of Black Nouveau.
Remember, in the coming week, do something to expand your world. Good night.
Good night.